everyone, and welcome back to an interview with Mr. Rajesh Talwar. This is your host, Ananya Sharma. So the book in discussion today is Aurangzeb, The Darkness in His Heart. So, Rajesh, was this a difficult play to write?
Hi Ananya, it's good to be with you and your team once again. Thank you for your question. Yes, this was a very difficult play for me to write. It's my second major historical play. The first one was on Gandhi, Ambedkar and the untouchability issue. This was more difficult because I had to go back further back into history. And the thing is that the history I was taught in school, I don't know how it is in your time, but in my days it was a very poor, sanitized kind of a history that was taught to us. And then when I went to college, it was a left-wing history which was taught, which spoke about historical processes which didn't really go into personalities. And in Aurangzeb's case, the personality is very important. So, yes, all these reasons it was a difficult play to write. Plus, I think there has been historical bias in the case of Aurangzeb particularly. And so sifting through the material, figuring out which historian was biased, which was not biased, or who was more independent, that was a daunting task. A difficult play to write indeed.
So, Rajesh, have you written about Aurangzeb's whole life? And if you have, was he a bad guy throughout the play?
Hi, Ananya. Yes, Aurangzeb was not a bad guy throughout, which is the case with most of us. The play is divided into three parts. Part one is Aurangzeb the Romantic. Yes, it may surprise the viewers to know that Aurangzeb was also a romantic. Part two, which is the major part, is Aurangzeb the Monster, which is how most of us know of him, as a monster. And part three is Aurangzeb the Fearful, when he is almost 90 years old and he is terrified of facing his maker. He is full of regrets. He is aware of the great follies that he's committed. And so these are the three parts.
So Rajesh, Aurangzeb the Romantic is something new. So can you tell us a bit more about that first?
Ananya, there are different versions of Aurangzeb's encounter with Hirabai, a dancing girl, whom he encounters at his aunt's house in Berampur. He goes to visit his aunt in Berampur, and there in the garden he espies a dancing girl who is climbing up a mango tree and singing a song. This is Hirabai. Hirabai is part of his uncle's harem. And it's love at first sight for Aurangzeb, who is a mature man, already married with children. But it's the first time that love has struck him so sharp and so deep. So he tells his aunt, "I want this girl." And she tells him, "But he's part of your uncle's harem. I can't do anything about it, and she is your uncle's favorite." Well, Aurangzeb says, "You have to find a way, aunt. You know, I have to get this girl." And then he meets Hirabai. He talks to her. He understands that she would, of course, wish to go with a young prince rather than be with an elderly uncle. Then she joins him in his prince's palace. Their romance continues. He is besotted with her. He is no longer his puritanical self. He starts enjoying music. He starts enjoying song. His brother Dara Shikoh is amazed. Shah Jahan, his father, is amazed. What happened to the Puritan Aurangzeb? How come he has started enjoying wine, music, song, the company of women to this extent that he spends hours with this young lady? And but unfortunately, Hirabai dies. You know, historians often remark that the future of India would have been different if Dara Shikoh had become the emperor and not Aurangzeb. That, of course, is true. But the future of India would also have been different if Hirabai had, the love of Aurangzeb's life, had not died so early. So when she joins Aurangzeb, they are together for less than a year. I think 9 to 11 months after this fiery romance, Hirabai gets the disease and she passes away. Aurangzeb is devastated. He thinks, why has this happened? When a tragedy occurs, all of us ask this question, why me? Why did it have to happen to me? And Aurangzeb also asks himself this question. And he comes to a conclusion that it was Allah's way for punishing him for having strayed from the virtuous path. So after her death, he becomes puritanical with a vengeance. So Hirabai's death not only changes Aurangzeb's life for the worse, she actually affects India's destiny.
So Rajesh, I'm pretty sure that the second part, that is Aurangzeb the monster, must be dealing with the way he behaved with his brother Dara Shikoh and father Shah Jahan.
Yes, of course Dara Shikoh is Shah Jahan's favorite, and Dara Shikoh is the prince regent. He is the person whom everybody understands will be the future emperor of Hindustan. Aurangzeb doesn't like Dara Shikoh for many reasons. Partly it is jealousy, and the play explores this theme that when a father has his favorite son or favorite child, other siblings may feel angry, they may feel jealous. I think the play explores this theme in a very sensitive way. Aurangzeb envies Dara Shikoh because of course Shah Jahan gives him a lot more money to spend. He's going to be the future king. Shah Jahan loves him more than he loves Aurangzeb. So Aurangzeb is jealous, but now that he's become his puritanical self, he also hates Dara Shikoh for what he feels is his great love for Hinduism. So there's an encounter in the play where Shah Jahan challenges him. He says that Aurangzeb, you became more open, you started drinking, you started enjoying music and dance, and now you have become puritanical again. And Aurangzeb says, well, I don't want to be like your other son, Dara Shikoh, who spends time with the Hindus, reading Hindu sacred texts. Because Dara Shikoh, and his portrait also comes across in this play, he's clearly fascinated by Hinduism. Yes, to come back to your question, part two, Aurangzeb the monster, it's about how eventually Aurangzeb has Dara beheaded. To add insult to injury, he has Dara beheaded in front of Dara's son. Dara is humiliated, he's made to dress up like a beggar, mounted on a dirty elephant, paraded through the streets of Delhi, and he is killed in a most cruel fashion. This is terrible. Ordinary people who love Dara, they are shocked. And Aurangzeb's treatment of his father, Shah Jahan, is no less cruel. Well, it is less cruel, but it is so cruel for the times even then, that the sheriff of Mecca refuses to grant Aurangzeb recognition as the king of Hindustan for this reason, for the way Shah Jahan has been treated. But this is just a few of the monstrosities which Aurangzeb commits. He destroys many Hindu temples. He asks that the idols which are destroyed should be placed before masjids which are going to be built under his rule. So he tries to humiliate the Hindus. He revives the jizya, the hated tax on Hindus, which was abolished for many years. And his treatment of the Sikhs is terrible. Through conniving and inducement, he gets the Sikh guru, Guru Tegh Bahadur, to come. And then his treatment of the Sikh guru is terrible. If you go to the Golden Temple, of course, there are portraits full of how Aurangzeb behaved towards the Sikhs. But not only towards Hindus and Sikhs is his ire directed, even towards the Shias, who he regards as a renegade sect, Aurangzeb is very cruel. He prepares a special dagger called Kush, and he says this Kush is going to be used to slaughter Shias. So his monstrosity is all around. It's not targeted only at the Hindus, it affects the Sikhs, it affects the Shias. He's an intolerant man, all around. And this is part two.
So Rajesh, you mentioned that Dara Shikoh was fascinated by Hindu scriptures. So can you tell us how he was similar and different to Akbar?
Dara Shikoh was fascinated by the Upanishads in particular, Ananya. And many of the Upanishads he had translated into Persian. So he undertook this task himself with the help of Hindu pundits. And there's an early encounter in the play where Aurangzeb comes to meet Dara Shikoh and his father. And Dara is busy with some Hindu pundits reading the scriptures, reading the Upanishads. And Aurangzeb says, "What are you doing?" He said, "This is a wonderful book. It's an Upanishad and I'm getting it translated into Persian." And Aurangzeb is furious. He said, "You read the books of the infidels and you are even translating them. How terrible." And Dara says, "Listen, all the great religions, they are speaking of the same truth. And the truth here will bring me and bring you closer to Islam. What is there in the Upanishads is also there in the true Islam." Aurangzeb is of course furious. He says, "How can you talk of the religion of the infidels, that it is similar to the great Islam? How can you even compare the two?" And he said, "If I become king, I'll have you beheaded." And Dara Shikoh tries to be reasonable. Dara also gets very angry. Shah Jahan then comes. This is an interesting encounter, but it shows that Dara, had he become the ruler, he would have had a very, very different treatment as far as the Hindu population was concerned. You ask, what is the similarity and difference between Dara and Akbar? Now, Akbar also, during the course of the play, it emerges that Akbar, you know, he tried to create the Dini Ilahi, which was a fusion between Hinduism and Islam. Because Akbar saw also many beautiful things in the Hindu religion. And as Dara points out in his discussion with Aurangzeb, he said, "Well, our grandfather, Akbar, he had, you know, our great-grandfather Akbar, he had the Hindu texts translated. So there is a precedent in the Mughals." And Aurangzeb says, "Well, he was also a fool if he did that." And so they have a discussion about it. But Akbar was already very powerful. He had consolidated power. He had been ruling India for many years when he decided to carry out this great experiment to create a fusion, the Din-i-Ilahi, which would take the best from Hinduism, the best from Islam, and was a state-sponsored religion of a kind, which was doomed to fail eventually because the two religions could not be reconciled. But Dara became interested at a much earlier age, and in a way he was foolish to do all this before becoming the future emperor. It was premature because it sent signals across the empire that this is a pro-Hindu emperor in the wings. And there were many powerful people who would have wished to support Aurangzeb as a hardliner, because the nobility at that time, although they were Hindus, they were predominantly Muslims. It's understandable because it was the Mughal dynasty. So Dara was, you can say, he was not as practical and hard-headed as his great-grandfather Akbar. He had similar breadth of understanding, and he was similarly liberal and enlightened, but he was not strategic enough. In fact, out of the two brothers, it was Aurangzeb who was the most strategic of the two.
Okay, Rajesh, so coming to the third part of the play, Aurangzeb the Fearful. Can you tell us about that?
The third part, Aurangzeb the Fearful. Aurangzeb has a long life. He's nearly 90 years old when he dies. In his 89th year, he's talking to Udaipuri, a concubine, and he's full of regrets, he's full of fear, because he now realizes all the terrible things he has done. He's full of regret. He's full of fear that how will Allah respond when he sees Aurangzeb before him as a sinner? How will he punish Aurangzeb? With what, you know, cruelty Aurangzeb treated his enemies, how can he expect mercy from God? How can he expect mercy from Allah? So he's a believer, but he's also now very fearful. So he's praying all the time. He is reading the Quran, which he has inscribed himself. He is talking to Udaipuri and he is saying, I'm so scared. What's going to happen to me when I'm face to face with my maker? I have done so many crimes. I have done so many wrong things. So it's interesting that the play now has had a few reviews, and at least three reviewers have said, yeah, Aurangzeb regretted what he did. But what's the point? If you kill thousands of people, if you destroy hundreds of temples, hundreds of grand monuments, if you are cruel towards your own family, and after that you regret everything, you're full of deep regret, but what is the worth of that deep regret? Because you cannot change the past. So that's the third part, where Aurangzeb is very self-aware. He realizes what he has destroyed. To Udaipuri, he even speaks of Dara, and he praises Dara to be a wise and a learned person. This is the same Aurangzeb who hated his brother. And now he says that actually it was Shah Jahan's fault, his father's fault, for having favored one particular son. So he's more aware, he's more reflective, and he's very, very fearful. This is the third part of the play, and his discussions are mostly with Udaipuri. So there are many interesting characters in this play. Of course, there is Shah Jahan, there is Dara Shikoh, and there is other people from the time. There is Aurangzeb's daughter, there is Aurangzeb's sister, who takes care of their father, Shah Jahan. But there are also two concubines, and Udaipuri is a very important character in the play. She used to be originally from Dara Shikoh's harem. So actually she is a concubine that Aurangzeb inherits from Dara Shikoh. So she knows both the brothers. She was with Dara Shikoh for many years. And once Dara Shikoh is beheaded, his harem naturally is at the disposal of Aurangzeb. And there are two very beautiful girls, and Aurangzeb wants them for himself. One of them, she's loyal to Dara Shikoh, Rana Dil. She disfigures her face so that she will not be attractive to Aurangzeb anymore. But Udaipuri, the second one, she is more practical. She says, let me go with Aurangzeb. I will have a good life in the harem. And then eventually she becomes close to Aurangzeb. But she has had a kind of ringside view of things, because she has been a concubine both with Dara Shikoh and later with Aurangzeb. She has a child from Aurangzeb. She becomes one of his wives, and she is the person whom he spends most time with during his last days. So Udaipuri is very central, and her perception of the two princes, that forms a crucial part of the ending of the play. So that's the third part.
So Rajesh, some people would say, let bygones be bygones. Why should we talk about Aurangzeb's cruelties, you know, in today's time? So what do you have to say about that?
Ananya, I think it's important for people to know the truth. And some people, they have this wrong perception that let's not talk about how cruel Aurangzeb was. The Muslims in our country will feel bad about that. They may feel they are under attack. That is not true at all. In fact, if you write a book about the cruelties of Aurangzeb, that shows into, you know, that throws light on the greater humanity of other Mughals. For example, you see that Akbar, you know, how enlightened he was. You see that Shah Jahan, he accepted his son was, Dara Shikoh was his favorite. He did not say, Dara Shikoh, you cannot, Dara, you are too, spending too much time with Hindus. He was tolerant as well. So actually, if you see the behavior of Aurangzeb, then it sort of casts the light on the greater tolerance of other Mughals. So we should not sweep, you know, things under the carpet, which some people want to do. There have been historians who have been writing about how great Aurangzeb was. Oh, actually, he didn't do anything bad. For example, there is a Western historian, Dr. Audrey Trishke. She has been playing mischief. She's even written a book, Aurangzeb, Thy Noble Soul. You know, now this would not be permitted in Europe if somebody were to write a book on how Hitler was actually a great man. Nobody would accept it. There would be all kinds of outrage, but in India we are so tolerant that there is no outrage when something like this happens. But she's clearly playing mischief. I say this because recently she tweeted some erroneous translations of the Ramayana, which were proved, you know, to be inaccurate. So she's just trying to be sensational. Then of course you have the left-wing communist historians who just want to talk about historical processes. So if to speak about Aurangzeb's cruelty, sometimes people feel that you're being right-wing or you're being a Hindu nationalist. That is not true at all. We should just speak the truth. It's something which students should know the truth about. And Jadunath Sarkar, I believe, he's given a very unbiased view of Aurangzeb. He talks about how he was the worst kind of ruler imaginable in a country which was composed of so many different races and creeds, that this kind of intolerance, you know, it was one of the reasons why the Mughal Empire would eventually break up. And how the Mughal Empire attained its zenith during the time of Akbar, who was a tolerant man, who saw to it that people from all different races, creeds, they all got a chance to be his advisors, who supported a kind of meritocracy far ahead of his times. So these are things which need to be talked about, and it's good to talk about Aurangzeb even in this day and age. Maybe it's even more relevant.
So Rajesh, do you think Akbar had many Hindu wives only as a part of his political strategy?
Good question, Ananya. I don't think this is the case. You know, this is what many people imagine, that it was only because of Akbar's political strategy that he took so many Hindu wives, especially the Rajput women. But the personal is political. There were certain events in Akbar's life that affected this decision of his. For example, many people don't know that there's a reason why Akbar liked the Rajput family, he respected Rajput traditions, he took Rajput women as his wife. This is something personal, it relates to how Akbar grew up. What happened is that Akbar's father Humayun, he had an encounter with Sher Shah and he was on the run, and Sher Shah was pursuing him. So Humayun ran with his wife and his son, his toddler, baby infant Akbar, and he went to Sindh. There he sought refuge with the Hindu Rajput king, and his wife stayed there, his infant baby stayed there, and then he went on with his wife towards Iran to get help from them to fight against Sher Shah. So Akbar actually spent a lot of time in this Hindu household, in this Hindu king's household. It's not only a matter of a couple of years. He was there for a short period when he was an infant, but then later he spent 5-6 years, and during a very formative period in his life. So he actually grew up with Hindu Rajput women all around him who were taking care of him. Now this kind of experience in childhood would have definitely affected Akbar's outlook towards Hinduism as a whole. You know, he realized that these are also beautiful people. They have a wonderful culture. Their religion also has wonderful things about it. And you can say that it affected not only his decision to take on Hindu Rajput wives, since he was a child and he found the girls around him attractive, even if they were sisters, but it also affected his later experiment to create the Dini Ilahi, his childhood experiences of growing up in a Hindu family. So our experiences affect our politics. And he may have used this as a matter of political strategy, but it was not purely a matter of political strategy. There were other reasons. For instance, there is a reason why Akbar was also very tolerant towards the Shias. He welcomed the Shias as fellow Muslims. He was tolerant all around. But as a point of fact, Akbar's father, Humayun, when he went to Iran, he took his wife with him because his wife was a Shia. So Akbar's mother was a Shia. How could he not be tolerant towards Shias having a mother who was Shia? And it was his mother who helped introduce his father to important Shia people in Iran, who gave him the support. And with their support, Humayun came back and, you know, he continued the rule of the Mughal Empire. So these are factors we need to take into account. And Aurangzeb himself was not aware of this history. He and Dara Shikoh had a common mother, but that didn't help to, you know, elevate his feelings towards of jealousy towards his brother. And he hated the Shias. There was nothing in his life which personally affected him. So to answer your question, no, it was not a matter purely of political strategy. There were these other reasons for why Akbar had many Hindu wives, for why Akbar was fascinated with the philosophical tenets of Hinduism, why he sought to create a fusion of the two religions. Short answer to that.
So Rajesh, what do you think that the renaming of the road in Delhi, the Aurangzeb Road, what do you think about that, and do you think it should have been done a long time ago than recently?
Yes, Ananya, I actually think that Aurangzeb Road should have been renamed many, many years earlier, because by and large Aurangzeb is not a good symbol for the unity of our nation. Some people will say, well, you know, the Muslims in our country may feel resentful that one of the Mughals, his name, the street is being, it was named after him and it will no longer be named after him. I don't think that's the case. This was a Mughal who persecuted Hindus, who persecuted Shias, who was all around intolerant, you know. He was not good for the community, was not good for the nation. So this name should have been wiped out long ago. There's no reason why any Muslim would feel bad about it. And what has been done is good, that you've removed Aurangzeb Road, but you put another Muslim there. Abul Kalam has replaced Aurangzeb Road, and this is something which nobody should have any objection with. The other thing is a matter of, handling things with delicacy and diplomacy. Now, for example, you can say that in undivided India, before partition, in undivided India, where the Muslim percentage was much higher in India, because you had Pakistan as well as Bangladesh, part of undivided India, then the distribution of symbols will be different. The distribution of street names will have some relation to the ethnic distribution, the ethnic composition, in a country. For example, if you have a country which has 90% Christians and 5% Buddhists, you cannot expect that you will have an equal number of Buddhist names and equal number of Christian names. So when India was created, which has an 80% Hindu population, then the renaming of new streets will naturally, it's just a common thing that there will be more Hindus. I don't think this is something to feel bad about. But yes, it should be done in a sensitive way. We should not offend anybody. But certainly street names, road names, they will be representative in a sense of the demographics of a particular country. So when undivided India had 40% Muslims and now it's only 20%, then it will have an impact inevitably on street naming. But it should not take a communal line. It should not be that, oh, we are the majority community, we need to have more of our streets, more of our gods. It should be in that kind of fashion. But on the other hand, it should not be that, any renaming should not be done. We must be too delicate. We must be too sensitive. It's just a matter of striking the right balance. So I think the majority community has a right to a greater number of symbols. This is nothing, to take exception to. But the whole thing has to be handled carefully. But to come back to your original question, yes, it's very good that Aurangzeb Road has been renamed. It's very good also, and it shows some delicacy that it has been renamed and replaced with another Muslim name. And I don't think anybody should have any objection to that.
So Rajesh, what have you done to make the play sound more authentic?
In my earlier play, which was on Gandhi and Ambedkar, another historical play, I used a lot of Gandhi's actual expressions, Ambedkar's actual words, and they were, interspersed through the play. And I've done something similar here. Aurangzeb writes a lot of letters to his sons, and in those letters he voices many fears, he voices many opinions. And now I have used his own words, but now they're in the form of a conversation with Udaipuri. So that makes it authentic. Since he did spend a lot of time with Udaipuri in his last days, and everybody repeats himself, especially when you get old, you tend to repeat yourself. I think it's perfectly okay to take a measure of artistic liberty to paraphrase Aurangzeb's own views and put them in the form of a conversation with Udaipuri. What kind of a conversation he would have. So that's some of the devices I've used. Then there are lots of real incidents which I've used. For example, the Chief Mufti comes and he talks to Aurangzeb and he says, what you're planning to do with the Shias is very wrong. And Aurangzeb says, no, I think the Shias are renegades, they are infidels, they are against the true Islam. So that's a real conversation. Aurangzeb has given his real views. In some cases I've had to make a choice. For example, Aurangzeb's first encounter with Hirabai, there are at least three or four different versions of it. So while choosing a version, I've not only chosen the most authentic sounding version, but I've also chosen the version which makes for the best drama. But they're all similar, but I've taken the most authentic version, which is also most dramatic. So these are some of the devices. Then I've peppered in some Persian words, some Urdu words in the conversations to make it sound more real. And overall, I think when it is staged, it will come across as very realistic. And the reviews also, because I have backed up everything with footnotes, with endnotes, with references to show that this is not something I'm just imagining. It's part of the history. For example, in a conversation, Aurangzeb tells Udaipuri, people, they don't seem to like me. And she says, what do you mean? He says, well, many years ago, somebody threw a stone at me. I was traveling in my chariot and somebody threw a stone. And she said, oh, well, that's not it. Once in a while, something will happen. And she says, no, once there was a Sikh who lunged at me with a sword. And she says, oh, when did that happen? He says, oh, it was soon after I had the Sikh Guru Tegh Bahadur executed. And she says, was that all? He says, no, there was even a water carrier who shouted at me, hey, Aurangzeb, you, come here. And he says, I was astonished. How can a water carrier dare to do that? So, of course, I had him flogged. But the point is, he must have known that he would be flogged. Now all these incidents, they are actually historically referenced, they actually happened. And so it's not something that I'm pulling out of a hat. And for a reader wants to be sure that his mind is not being manipulated by the playwright or by anyone, because you want the truth. And since the references are there, they can verify for themselves. So I think these are some devices which I've used to make the play sound more authentic.
And with that, we come to the end of yet another episode.
Thanks, Ananya. It's been a pleasure to be with you once again. We've come to the end of the second discussion of a historical play. And thank you. Thank you to all your team. And hope to be with you again very soon.
This was your host, Ananya Sharma. And stay tuned with us because we'll be back with more books and more discussions in the near future.